when you are a Muslim, meaning that you submit fully to the commands of Allah, then you have to accept the commands of Allah as they are and don't change them. Don't you come and make something permissible that God has made impermissible, and don't make something impermissible that God has made permissible, because in fact, this is a form of worship. How is that? When the verse was revealed in Surah At-Tawbah, which is the 9th chapter of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله والمسيح ابن مريم. They took their rabbis and monks as lords besides Allah. And also al-Masih ibn Maryam, the Messiah, the son of Mary, Jesus alayhi salam. Adi ibn Hatim, who was a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to the Prophet, we didn't used to worship them. Right? We didn't used to worship the rabbis, the monks. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, did not they make permissible what Allah made impermissible? And so you also made it permissible? And didn't they make impermissible what Allah made permissible? And so therefore you made it permissible. So in other words, you were following them in the way that they legislated things. And Allah is saying, this is the right of God alone to decide what is permissible and what is not, what is lawful and what is not, what is moral and what is not. This theme carries over throughout the Quran because, and this is the point that is very important, because those who don't follow that are basically saying that we actually have the same right as the messengers of God. And you look at what was talked about yesterday and also mentioned again today about that radical skepticism. And so you find it here again. They say, we will not believe until we are given. We're not going to believe until we're given what the messengers were given. In other words, until revelation comes to us. Allah knows best where to put his message. He knows best who to give his revelation to. And so it's not for us to determine what is lawful or unlawful or moral or immoral. And so you travel over now. Let's look at, for example, the beginning of Surah Al-A'raf, and we look at what the mushrikeen, the idolaters again, they're saying, وَإِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً قَالُوا وَجَدْنَا عَلَيْهَا أَبَاءَنَا وَاللَّهُ أَمَرَنَا بِهَا. When they do some act of immorality, they say, this is what we found our fathers doing. This is what we found our ancestors doing. And Allah commanded us to do this. قُلْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَأْمُرُ بِالْفَحْشَةِ. Allah does not command with immorality. You go even further. You just, a couple more pages. قُلْ مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِينَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي أَخْرَجَ لِعِبَادِهِ. Who is it? Say, who is it that makes impermissible the adornment that Allah has made permissible for his servants? This was a reveal about the Arabs who would go around the Kaaba. They would circumambulate the Kaaba naked. They wouldn't wear any clothes because they were saying that it's impermissible to wear the clothes. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, who is it that has made impermissible what I have made permissible? And so it's very important that we recognize this point here. Now, does that mean that we're not going to sin, that we're not going to fall into disobedience to Allah? No, it doesn't mean that. And in fact, we get this at the very beginning of the chapter, the 7th chapter, Surah Al-A'raf, when we look at the story of Adam, alayhi salam, he disobeyed Allah. He ate from the tree. Okay, but he also repented. Now, here's an important point. I hope that we really pay attention to this. This is a takeaway for every Muslim and for non-Muslims as well. If we recognize that what we are doing is wrong, then we have a chance for repentance. We have a chance to turn back to Allah because we know that what we have done is wrong. And we're all going to be those people who do things that are wrong from time to time. And we're going to need God to forgive us for those things, and we're going to turn to him in repentance. But if we don't believe that what we are doing is wrong, and we actually believe that we have the right now, yeah, I know that this is what it says in the Quran, and I know that the Prophet ﷺ said this, but I'm going to rationalize my way out of it. I'm going to actually figure out a way to make this seem halal for me. Then I'm never going to repent from that. And this is exactly what happened in the story of Iblis. When he says, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to bow to Adam, he said, "What? Ana khayrun min khalaqtani min nar wa khalaqtahu min teen. I am better than him. I'm not prostrating to him because I am better. I know that this is what you commanded me to do, ya Allah, but it doesn't make sense to me." And see, so what happens is when we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to do something, we can't follow the way of those who rejected the messengers. We should not be like those who denied the messengers and rejected faith. Allah is telling us in Surah Al-An'am, beware of that path, because that is a path that will take you down a very slippery slope and you may not be able to come back from it. So if there's something that comes to you from guidance, meaning it comes to you from the Quran, it comes to you from the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and maybe you don't really understand it, that's okay. It really is, because a lot of us, I mean, it doesn't matter how long you study, you're going to learn new things every day. There are things that you didn't understand yesterday that you'll understand today. And subhanAllah, if you're tuning into this right now, you're watching it live or you watch it later, and you're trying to understand the Quran, know that this is the path that Allah wants for you. And Allah Azza wa Jal, if he wants guidance for somebody, yashrah sadrahu lil Islam, he will open his heart up to full submission, which is what Islam is, right? To full submission. And when you submit fully, you will find that inner peace and you'll get salvation in the next life. And if you don't and you fight it, you're not going to find any inner peace, because your fitrah, your natural disposition, wants to obey the commands of God. Okay, so if you fight that, there's going to be inner turmoil, and you're subjecting yourself to losing out on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy in the hereafter. So again, if you're watching this right now, this is a good sign. Keep learning, keep studying revelation. And as the dua, our prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make a very important prayer. He would say, "Wahdini, yani, oh Allah, guide me, wa yassir al-huda li, and make guidance easy for me." Because sometimes we know what we're supposed to do, but it's not easy for us. Sometimes it's not easy because we don't really understand fully, well, why am I supposed to do this? And why am I not supposed to do that? The point is that we know what we're supposed to do and what we're not supposed to do. And as we continue in knowledge, then hopefully Allah will give us that light so that we understand the rationale behind his commands and his prohibitions. The point here, and I'll close here, Sheikh Omar, I'm sorry for going over my time. But the point that I'd like to close with is that we have to do our best. And as we begin to forge our American Muslim identity, if you will, we have to do our best to make sure that what we are doing is totally in line to the best of our ability with the commands of God. It is He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has the right to determine that which he wants us to do and that which he wants us to do, that which is moral and that which is immoral, and is our job, it is our duty as Muslims to submit to that and then to seek that knowledge that will help us to better understand his commands and his prohibitions. Wallahu a'lam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa barak, ala nabiyyina Muhammad.
Wallahi barak fiik, ya Doctor. SubhanAllah, just one reflection as you were speaking, I can't help but share it. You know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described pride as two. He said, pride is ghamsu nas aw batr al-haq, which is to either belittle people or to reject the truth. Rarely do you see that a person who rejects the truth does not belittle others, because there's a sign of arrogance that's going to be there. But at the same time with Shaytan, with the devil, in that one moment, he actually did both, right? He belittled the creation of man, and Adam alayhi salam and his descendants, and he rejected the truth through his rationale and things of that sort. And we might escape one form of pride, might not be condescending to people, but we want to unlock things for ourselves. And so, as you said, always try to find the loopholes and find our way out. That's inherent in man, that when their desires become too prominent and unrestricted, that they're going to start finding a way to make those desires in accordance with, or to make truth in accordance with the pursuit of those desires, so that they don't have to commit to anything that's uncomfortable. And so, alhamdulillah, I was not uncomfortable with either one of you tonight. Jazakumullah khairan for not making us uncomfortable. Beautiful reflections as always.